Ladies and gentlemen of the Alliance, you have been in the habit of seeing this bug stuck away in a corner on credit cards of every motion picture. This is one production in which the IA bug is featured. Our insignia represents a half century of struggle, sacrifice, and service. Truly, we can be proud of it.
Mr. Walsh, Mr. Dan Tracy calling from Washington. Yes, sir. I have Mr. Walsh for you. Go ahead, please.
Hello, Dan. How are you? What's on your mind? I see. You have a problem there. Yes, I'll drop over to Washington next week and we'll see if we can't take care of that. It's been nice hearing from you. I'll be seeing you, and in case you see Scott, give him my regards. So long now.
So you think you've got problems, eh?
I don't seem to know you.
My name is Williams, John G. Williams. I was the first president of the Alliance. I was elected in 1893.
Card number one, local number one, New York. It's a pleasure meeting you, Brother Williams. Say, this is great. The first president of the Alliance and, but I thought that you
were... And you were right. I left this earth some years ago, Mr. Walsh.
Dick is the name.
Dick. Thank you. Well, sir, it was the longest road tour I ever took. I told St. Peter about that pink contract we got after the Peoria Convention, that I was supposed to be sent back to where I came from, and in a sleeper, too. But, St. Peter just smiled at me.
I can understand that.
Yes, sir, we've got a pretty good local up there. We're all flymen now.
Well, Brother Williams, I'm glad you dropped down. Won't you have a chair?
Well, thanks. I haven't got long. You see, we're putting on a benefit show for some of the fallen angels. Now, don't let a problem or two worry you, Dick. Our path is strewn with them. Well, I remember back before the Alliance was organized. It was 1886.
The stagehand of yesteryear, like the actor, worked untiringly in the belief they had in the future of the theater. The stagehands were paid the magnificent sum of 50 cents a show, and they carried in and out for nothing. The electrician of today was the gas man of that era. There were miles of pipes in the theater. They were lit by the sandbox, which ground out a spark to ignite the gas. And the gas man was no better paid than other stagehands, even with the price of pork chops at £3 for 25 cents, and eggs at 26 for a quarter. And there still was the landlady who wanted her rent, and 50 cents a show didn't go very far.
In 1887, the People's Theater on the Bowery introduced electricity. It was the first theater to be equipped with it. Of course, they had to generate their own juice, but that was before you became an electrician, Dick.
A few years, anyway.
Martin Kruger of the Chicago Opera House built the first arc lamp. Our boys made valuable contributions to the art of lighting. The carpenters improved the technique of building sets, and still they were paid starvation wages. The stagehand had to take odd jobs to keep himself alive and to support his family. He realized that if he could get a dollar a show and 50 cents for carrying in and out, then he'd be sitting pretty. So the first strike of the stagecraft took place in 1888. One of the theaters affected was the Academy of Music. Strike breakers were brought in. The strike itself was the shortest in history. Lewis James, the famous tragedian, unwittingly helped the cause, as he was saying,
"To be or not to be, that is the question. Whether it is nobler in the mind to suffer."
I'm sorry, Mr. James, terribly sorry.
When the regular stagehands come back, Mr. Gilmore, I'll go on with my performance, and not before. My life is worth more than this engagement.
So we got our dollar a show, and 50 cents for carrying in and out. But this increase only benefited the stagehand in one locality. Others still received the 50 cents a show, and in some instances, 25 cents. And those who went with road companies had another problem, and that was getting home. This is probably the reason why so many of our members have inherited fallen arches. The Chicago World's Fair played an important part in the formation of the National Alliance. From every key city came theatrical mechanics, and viewpoints were exchanged. The boys had organized in various parts of the country, but were not satisfied with their progress. We all realized that great benefits would be derived from and through a national organization. Our first convention of the Alliance was held in Elks Hall at 27th Street and Broadway, New York City, on July the 17th, 1893. We only had 16 delegates, but it was a start anyway.
Brothers, will the convention please come to order?
Brother Chairman, I make a motion that each local be assessed $2.75 to pay the expense of printing the bylaws.
Brother Chairman, I move we should lay $100 aside for current expenses.
Brother Chairman, we owe the sum of $11 for special services. I make a motion that each local pay $1 apiece.
Brother Chairman, I move that we buy a typewriter.
What do you want to do, bankrupt the Alliance?
But of course, we had more important business to discuss, Dick. But then everything was important to us.
You boys deserve a lot of credit. But no one man or group of men can take bows for the success of the IA. But at that first convention, there was one man present who did more than his share.
He sure did. I never saw such a hustler. Yes, sir, Lee M. Hart carried the IA in his pocket. And our loyal forces struggled desperately in the face of overwhelming odds. And the cause and the sacrifices at times seemed almost hopeless. But our boys fought on undaunted, inspired with the spirit that makes real union members out of men who flatly refuse to be defeated. And our drive for recognition and new members went on untiringly. And then it happened. In July, 1894, we were chartered by the American Federation of Labor. And at the second convention, which was held in the Crystal Hall in Chicago, Lee M. Hart became our president. Hart was one of the really great leaders of our alliance. It was under his leadership, first as president, later as general secretary treasurer, that the economic strength of the alliance began to assert itself. Under his administration, the IA emerged from a few scattered organizations to a powerful nationwide union. Even then, we felt that members of the Alliance had the ability and the knowledge to take over all the technical jobs in the theatrical field.
We had no idea what the peep show would lead to then. Every man was his own projectionist and didn't carry a card either. Conditions and salaries were improving, though it was a very slow process. The road men must be given credit for not only making friends for the Alliance, but spreading trade unionism among the theatrical workers of the country. Even the most optimistic men never dreamed that the Alliance would someday become one of the most powerful labor organizations in the world. It was hard to be optimistic with the average wage of grips, operators, and flymen at $1.25 a show. This even included doing odd jobs for the manager or his family. and people still got a kick out of the penny version of the cinema. The amusement parks gave our men employment, but they were invaluable with their knowledge of stagecraft. Meanwhile, the National Alliance had added the word international to its illustrious title. Then one fine day, the peep show grew up. Of course, it still wasn't too good, but it was a big improvement. The IBEW wanted the projectionists to affiliate with their union, but in 1908, at Philadelphia, the boys decided to bring the projectionists into the IA. The road to success was still rough. We had powerful opponents, and even then, the press would never give us a fair break. During this period, we had many controversies. Some we won and some we lost. But we continued on our way. We even got used to the bumpy road. At the 19th annual convention at Niagara Falls, Charles C. Shea was elected president. Charlie Shea was more wedded to the ideals and principles of the Alliance than the countless newlyweds who viewed the eighth wonder of the world. He pledged at this convention that the decision made at Philadelphia to bring the projectionists into the Alliance would become a reality. And he kept his promise.
Charlie always had an angle. You've probably heard about the strike in the Crescent and Delane theaters in New Orleans. The only way the strike breakers could get in or out of the theaters was up through a manhole outside the stage door. The strike didn't last long. Charlie did everything in a very dignified manner. He always gave it that little personal touch.
It was through the efforts of Charlie Shea that Sunday shows were permitted in New York. At the Peoria Convention in 1912, the White Contract was originated. It was our first IA contract for the roadmen. Prior to this, we signed the manager's contract on his terms.
Later, that contract became known as the Pink Contract. Now, why it changed color, I don't know. But now the workers had to receive 2 weeks' notice and be returned to the town from which they came, and in a sleeper, too. It's practically the same contract as the one used today.
That's right.
I always get a kick out of the story they tell on Louis Krauss. When he hitchhiked from Philadelphia to the Seattle Convention in 13 to get a charter for his local. And when he couldn't get a lift, he walked. And when he got tired of walking, he ran. Louis was always superstitious about that cap. It brought him luck at the Seattle Convention in 1913, so he took it to every convention after that.
Well, it was at Seattle that the biannual convention meeting was conceived, and the yellow card system was originated by District Number 1. Oh yes, Krauss got his charter. Louis Krauss served the Alliance as an international officer for over 30 years. And was retired at half salary in 1945. Through the untiring efforts of Charlie Crickmore and Ernie Clark, a per diem fund was established. No more hitchhiking for delegates. Every local, regardless of the number of its members, could now be represented at all conventions. About this time, Hollywood started to make motion pictures. And many stagehands who had previous experience in the East came west. At the old Universal Studios, they called the crew snowbirds because they came from all over the country. The stage itself prospered. The stagehand was treated with consideration. The Alliance commanded respect. It was in 1919 that the Actors' Equity went on strike. Ethel Barrymore, Lillian Russell, Pearl White, DeWolf Hopper, Eddie Cantor, Joseph Santley, Barney Bernard, Ed Wynn, Ned Sparks, yes, and many, many others, fought vainly for fair play.
Among those who were in there pitching was our beloved friend Marie Dressler. Ethel Barrymore made the shortest speech of her career when she said, "All my family are with you, heart and soul." To Wolf Hopper said, "I could not live with myself if I didn't stand beside my friends and my co-workers. What is money compared with integrity?"
The actors had many friends, among them the IA, who went out on strike to help their brothers and sisters. As Charlie Shea said, "The managers are betting on a color that I don't believe exists in the actor. You're not going to lose, but if you do go down in defeat, you'll have the stagehands with you and we'll stick together as long as God lets us live." In the early 20s, when William F. Canavan so successfully guided the destiny of the Alliance, there was a union busting drive throughout the country. The Alliance not only escaped it, but rose to new heights.
On January the 1st, 1925, the Studio Mechanics, Local 37, joined the IA, and the organization of the studios began in earnest. The previous organizational attempts had ended in failure due to the strike of 1919.
In 1927, the cameramen joined forces with us. That was in the silent era. And then one fine day...
Mammy, the sunshine beats, the sunshine wet, but I know where the sunshine's best. Mammy, Mammy, my heartstrings are tangled around Alabama. I'm a coming. Sorry, I made you wait. I'm coming. I hope and trust I'm not late. Mammy, Mammy, I'd walk a million miles for one of your smiles, for my Mammy. Oh, Mammy, my little Mammy. The sunshine's east, the sunshine's west, but I know where the sunshine's best. It's on my Mammy I'm talking about, nobody else's. My little Mammy, my heartstrings are tangled around Alabama. Mammy, I'm coming. I hope I didn't make you wait. Mammy, I'm coming. Oh, God, I hope I'm not late. Mammy, don't you know me? It's your little baby. I'd walk a million miles for one of your smiles, for my Mammy.
It's a fad. It can't last.
Oh, yeah? Well, that's what you think. Get a load of this.
A pretty girl is like a melody that haunts your mind and air. Just like a strain of a haunting refrain, she'll start upon a marathon and run around your brain. You can't escape. She's in your memory, but
In 1929, the laboratory technicians were chartered. The IA continued to grow. Then came the sound technicians, the film exchange inspectors, shippers, the motion picture theater employees, the motion picture makeup artists, the costumers, the treasurers and ticket sellers were added to the ever-increasing family. And they were closely followed by the office employees of the film exchanges. The theater wardrobe attendants got their charter, and so did the first aid employees and the film editors, one of the most important crafts in the motion picture industry. Then the television broadcasting studio employees joined the IA.
We've got quite a gang now. You know, Dick, there's only one man still with you who helped to set up that first local in New York.
Who's he?
George Olmsted. He's still working at Grauman's Chinese Theater in Hollywood.
I didn't realize that he was the only one left.
Yes, sir. He has seen the Alliance grow from that first local in New York to the great organization it is today. And that's the story of the IA.
Have you forgotten a few things?
No, I don't think so.
How about 1933?
Oh, the strike. I guess I forgot that one on purpose, Dick. We really took a beating. We tried to gain recognition for the sound local in the motion picture industry, but we failed miserably. Our membership in Hollywood dropped to practically nothing.
Yeah, maybe if you think of 1935, you'd feel better.
Yes, 1935 really started us going again. The strike started in the theaters in Chicago and spread. And it wasn't long until the producers were ready to talk. And the Alliance was restored to the position it held in 1933. And the studios began operating closed shop.
Now the IA label appeared on every motion picture. All labor was performed under the jurisdiction of the IATSE. The IA basked in the sun of prosperity. But in 1940 came the greatest test the Alliance had ever been called upon to face. Trusted and honored leaders betrayed us. Our great organization was defamed. We were harshly criticized by virtually every newspaper in the nation. The repercussions of this dark hour shook the very foundation of the Alliance. And if the structure hadn't been sound, we never would have survived. We weathered the storm and came through stronger than ever.
That's where you came in, Dick, and we're forever grateful for what you've done.
I had a lot of help and cooperation, especially from a man by the name of Fred Rao and our friends in the American Federation of Labor.
I don't think any labor man ever stepped into as difficult a spot as you did.
Well, it wasn't exactly a bed of roses.
Frankly, I never thought you'd be able to negotiate contracts for the Hollywood locals. That was really something, Dick. I told some of the boys up there that the locals actually had signed contracts with the Hollywood studios, and by gad, they wouldn't believe me.
You know, it took us some time to believe it ourselves.
Oh, I'll never forget when you went before the Columbus Convention. That built up a lot of confidence in you. But your biggest job was selling the Alliance to the people, to recapture the fine reputation the IA had enjoyed. And Dick, you certainly did do that.
You mean we did it, Brother Williams. As I've said before, no one man, a group of men, can take credit for the success of the IA. It's what we've done together.
Well, have it your own way, Dick. But you will admit that you helped a little bit to settle the 1945 strike in the Hollywood studios, won't you?
I did my best. And sometimes it didn't seem to be good enough. We were fighting for our very existence. We didn't ask for this fight, but we couldn't avoid it. So we squared off and once again came out victorious.
I hope things will be a little easier for you now, Dick.
We all hope that, but we're bound to have our problems. With the foreign market shaky, television, and the Taft-Hartley bill, we can't afford to let down now
Not for 1 minute.
You're really worried about the Taft-Hartley bill, aren't you?
Naturally. It directly affects our members. And no one can foretell what the future holds. But there's one thing certain, that we must work together now, as we always have. Only now, we must work harder. We must preserve the integrity of the Alliance, which was dedicated to the founders and pioneers of our Alliance, in some of whose blood its early history was written. It was their sweat, their sacrifice, their physical and moral courage that laid the groundwork from which to build. These men, most of whom never achieved deserved recognition, toiled unselfishly and tirelessly in behalf of the organization and what it represented, whose deeds are unsung because of their anonymity, but who actually form the backbone of our International. Nor should we be unmindful of those who followed and endured unbelievable hardships to maintain and bequeath to us the grand institution that stands today. All made noble and lasting contributions to the cause, which can be repaid only through the perpetuation of the ideals for which they so valiantly struggled.